Good morning to our faculty and staff, our knowledgeable others, our guests, and most of all, our students who gave up their Sunday morning. We appreciate your presence today. We are here today for the Rising Up with Active Learning, and today we will observe Dr. Rebecca Robinson with the educational psychology class. And so we will buckle up and observe, and we are in for a treat today.
About something before we start our moving, because y'all know we're going to, in a jigsaw, we're going to move. But I want to talk about the ethics, the Alabama Educator Code of Ethics, just a little bit, and let you talk some about it, so that when you go to your groups, you're going to have some readings and a video, and you're going to talk about the standards in relation to these selections, either reading or video. You're going to have ethical feelings about certain things that come up when you become a teacher. If you look at my question, I've got on this chart right here. Shamarla, can you loudly read that top question?
What are some ethical dilemmas that teachers face?
Okay, what's a dilemma?
A problem.
Problem. Issue. Something that comes up. Roger, what is number one?
Professional conduct.
So standard two, trustworthiness. Does an educator need to be trusted?
All the time.
He said it, all the time, and he was quick too. So I want you to think about a teacher that you know that has exemplified trustworthiness. And I want you to talk at your tables about 3 minutes, about 1 minute each, to share a teacher you know that exemplifies trustworthiness.
Somebody I consider to be trustworthy would be Dr. Bridgewater. Yeah. The reason I say this is because I feel like if you're not sure about some assignments and stuff, you can go talk to her and like she'll be like talking back to you and giving you like insight on how you can go about doing it and stuff like that. Yes.
So we know we need trustworthy teachers, and I know that's what you're going to be. In the Alabama Code of Ethics, number three is unlawful acts. That just kind of goes without saying. Standard four, teacher-student relationship. Professional responsibility is defined in different ways by different people, but they spell it out pretty clearly here. And they're telling you, that you've got to be careful. Read eight. Z, would you read eight?
Maintenance of confidentiality.
That means I can't discuss Elijah's grade with Shamarla. Okay, we're getting ready to go now to our expert groups. Because y'all know we're going to move. If you'll look at your group at your table, this is your home group.
You can be not friendly with your students, but just make sure you have boundaries. If you see them at a basketball game, you can like speak, but don't be all hugs and etc.
Job promote or job retain?
That she ain't gonna be nothing but another dropout in pregnancy statistic. And I feel like this unfair for the Nicole, like her, because you don't know what the lady capable of.
thing is, what was their point?
I don't know.
Like what the, like how do they think the kids learned anything by just them giving them the answer?
Yeah, I agree on what you said too, because you know, a lot of folks don't handle taking standardized tests or any test period well. They might break down or they just might freeze up and they won't cope back from that. And how would you like help the students out by just removing it? Because came that next year, they ended up removing that this particular test from that state. Now we gotta go back to our home group, y'all.
I think everybody is finished teaching their group. You all had a lot to say. I'm proud of you. I heard some very, very interesting and deep comments. So I think you now have a good idea of ethics. Did it take the scenarios for you to fully understand what ethics is? Kind of, sort of? Okay, I want to take a few more minutes and let somebody share out about each of the scenarios and dilemmas that we talked about. Okay, what was number one about?
A teacher, she was texting a student over text while she was at work. So we had put a standard, we did three. We did teacher-student relationship, unlawful acts. We put unlawful acts because we don't know if she was convicted when she left the trial. And then we put professional conduct because she wasn't professional while on the job.
Okay, who can share out about number two? Okay, Takana.
We had an article called Promotion or Retention, and basically it was a group of eighth grade teachers trying to decide whether they wanted to promote a student or hold the student back. The student was 16, well, finna be 16, reading on a fifth grade level, and she was failing two classes, science and social studies. So they were trying to decide what to do. The standard I picked was trustworthiness and teacher-student relationship. And I chose the teacher-student relationship because one of the teachers was using, had her personal feelings involved. And, you know, as a teacher, like, you gotta show some sympathy, but you can't let that decide, you know, the professional side of the teacher and student relationship.
That is an age-old question, to retain or not to retain. I was faced with it many times as a principal. And Elijah, you kind of had a different opinion. I think Takaya thinks that she should be retained. What did you think, right quick?
When it come to this situation, she was 55 in science, less than that in social studies, but like her reading skills had improved. Like in a single year, had gone up. She was reading in third grade, now she's reading in fifth grade. And then she's went through three foster homes, bounced everywhere, and then they said that school was the only place that she had felt stable.
That's why I feel. You go ahead, promote her, just see what she do. Then if she don't do well, then it's like, oh dang, well, hold her back in the ninth grade.
They did not say what actually happened in the scenario, but there's more text that you can read. But that's very interesting, and it does involve ethics. It's not as cut and dried. All right, let's go quickly to three, and I want Khadijah to talk because she was there. She's got some schema. She's got some personal experience. So go.
I had the Atlanta educators convicted in the school cheating scandal, and basically what had happened was it was a group of teachers and in the whole district of Georgia was convicted of cheating on the standardized CRCT test. And I felt like they was wrong for doing it. And it also happened at one of my schools that I was at in elementary. And a couple of my friends, they was convicted in cheating, but technically they wasn't because the teachers was giving them the answers to the test. And I think they wasn't necessarily trying to give the answers to the students. I think they was more so just trying to help out the students because a lot of students don't necessarily do good on any standardized test, and came that next year, they went on trial for it to try to take that particular test out the state, and they ended up passing it. And I think till this day, they still are talking about the scandal. And that's it.
Did they go to jail, Kadesh?
The teachers did, and a couple of my friends did.
Students?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's rough. Okay. All right, back to our question. Take your orange card. This is your exit ticket assignment. What are some ethical dilemmas that teachers face? We talked about three, so at least put down two. Put down two dilemmas. Flip it over. Choose one of the scenarios discussed. And tell how you, as the teacher, would have conducted yourself. I want to thank all of you so much for your participation today. I'm very, very proud of the way you got in there and really got involved in these dilemmas on a Sunday morning when you really wanted to be asleep. So, thanks again. And Dr. McKay, that concludes my lesson.
The engagement between the students was, I think your notes, your questions were good, because it gave them a direction and they were able to follow it and go back to their tables and teach. It was very, I think, very good.
The first thing I really appreciated was the fact that you took the standards and then you explained. Had them think about what each keyword meant. Like Clinton, I was really curious to hear what they were going to say about a teacher that exemplified trustworthiness to them. And I think that would have been good for them to at least get their, as you say, find their voice, have their voice then, even though they had their voice all the way. But I was curious to see what they were going to say about those previous teachers and how they exemplified trustworthiness.
I think I can do this with the parts of speech. I think I can put the jigsaw method.
I thought about parts of speech.
Yeah, we need to talk.
I've got a little English background.
We need to talk. I think I can execute that in my classrooms and it be effective, because that seems to be like the biggest problem is parts of speech and commas. They're just hard. And I think they could... yeah, gain something from that.
I also thought about the multiple moving parts in the lesson. So the complexity of the lesson had a lot of moving parts, and your what ifs, I think was a great way to think about, well, what if the technology doesn't work, right? Or the videos can't be pulled up. What's going to be my alternative to that? What ifs? And the important part about what ifs, I think, is for the teacher candidates to start to think about, well, what if a student struggles in the lesson? You know, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? What's my alternative there? So I think you modeled the what ifs for them very effectively.
I would say overall today was great. I actually took Dr. Robinson at psychology class last semester. So it was a refresher to go over the ethical standards, and it put us in a perspective, if we was to ever be in this situation, what would we do as a teacher?
My viewpoint was, if you just look on paper and you see those two failing grades, like, okay, they're a failing student. But if you look at that situation matched up to the effort they put in and their grades, then it's like, okay, it might paint a whole different picture. It's like, are they doing their best, or are there still more that they could be doing?
I used to be scared to talk in front of a group of people. So my teacher, she would want me to do certain stuff, but I wouldn't do it because I was scared to do it. And so she would allow me not to do it because, you know, she liked me as a student, and she know that my grades was good and et cetera. But she had to put that aside because she knew that I was going to need to eventually get over that, because I would have to talk, especially if I'm going to be a teacher, I got to stand in front of a group of people or a class and talk to them.
The jigsaw kind of creates a classroom within the classroom, if that makes any sense. So it gives us the opportunity to use our teaching skills and the things that we've learned here.
It feels like every class I'm in throughout these years for education, it always brings me back into when I'm in high school and, like, what can I do better when I become a teacher? And it's like, I feel like, you know, once I'm graduated, I'll be the best teacher, because it's like all of these hands-on activities that we do really helps us. And also with all the questions and discussions that we get, you know, it helps our voice also.
We just want to thank all of you, and I don't want to negate anyone, even the people who are out there in the streamland. Thank you all so much. I appreciate you.